Jesus' name. Periscope going right here. There we go. Wake up in your mind. Get up in your thinking and move in your purpose. Hallelujah. So remember, we were talking about on Wednesday, when we learn to wait on the Lord, that when you start to learn to wait, things start to happen. Things start to change, and circumstances that you never thought would, why was this happening to me? Just for the simple fact that when you're waiting on the Lord, you're not in a dormant position. You cannot take a sit down position. When you're waiting on the Lord, you must still what? Walk by faith and not by sight. We have to move into a position that we know who God is. And when you know who God is, you know how to operate. You know how to, you know how to act. You know how to speak. You know how to treat one another. Oh my God, tell somebody today that we need to learn to love one another. But remember, James 1, we're taught right there is to what? In verse 2, let's go back to verse 2, which we were on Wednesday. It says, my brethren, talking to all of us, count it all joy when you fall into various trials. And just, and I like that word various. It let me know that there's going to be one more than one trial. And I'm recognizing that when one trial goes, here comes another. And the biggest thing is that we don't allow ourselves to sit down in the trial. You got to count it joy and keep it moving. You got to count it joy and say, you know what? I am not going to let myself get bogged down. Oh my God, I can tell there's one person on this broadcast today. You may listen later. You are in a bogged down situation because you keep resting in the trials. You keep holding on in the trials, expecting God to come pull you out. When if you don't pay attention to the trial and pay attention to the joy, my God, you don't even pay. It doesn't even, it's not even recognizable. You don't, it doesn't even give you warrant to pay attention to, because you know it's coming. You know it's coming. You know that the enemy is out there to kill, steal, and destroy. He has not given up. He has not let you off the hook. And watch this. You have not been given a right path just because you say you choose Jesus. No, when you choose Jesus, you take on what? First of all, going after him. Then you take on denying yourself. Then you take on taking up your cross. And then you learn to follow him. Well, don't you know when you're following him, there's trials coming. They're coming. They're coming. They're coming. But what do? Count it all joy when you fall into various trials, knowing that testing your faith produces patience. See, waiting on the Lord is patient, not to get ahead of him. See, waiting on the Lord is being patient, because now you can listen for his voice. We said it the other day. Do you know the voice of the Lord? Have you really petitioned to him and said, God, use me? Have you really got on the altar and said, I am here. Here I am. Send me. Use me in any way, fashion, form that you choose. My God. But let patience have its perfect work, that you may be perfect and complete, lacking nothing. You are not supposed to be lacking anything. And I know some people say, well, I don't have that kind of car that person has. That has nothing to do with what you are. Watch this. In a lacking stage. See, you, if you remember in Psalms, he told us, he said, when you wait on the Lord and be of good courage, he shall strengthen your heart. Your mind is where God dwells and where God is requiring us to get to a realm of protection. Knowing that I know how to act, I count it all joy. And I know that by counting it all joy, my faith would produce patience. There's somebody out there needs some patience today, some patience to say, you know what? I'm gonna stop doing me, and I'm gonna stop getting ahead of God, and I'm gonna slow my roll and wait on the Lord and be of good courage. See, being of good courage means you are courageous to stand. You are courageous to go through. You are courageous to trust in God and not yourself. But a lot of times we trust in ourselves because that's all we know. We trust in ourselves because we see ourselves looking like someone else, sounding like someone else. But knowing that it's up to me to act like the one who came for me, for me to start to resemble the one that died for me to start to resemble the one that made a way for me. And he made a way for you too. Watch this. If any of you lacks wisdom, let him ask of God, who gives to all liberally without reproach, and it will be given to him. But let him ask in faith and no doubting. For he who doubts is like a wave of the sea, driven and tossed by the wind. For let not that man suppose that he will receive anything from the Lord. He is a double-minded man, unstable, my God, in all his ways. I like that part right there because it lets me know there is no middle ground. It doesn't let me off the hook that I'm good one day and I'm bad the next day. If I am double-minded, I am unstable in all my ways. If I say one thing today and I say something else tomorrow, that means I'm double-minded. And it does not justify, watch this, it does not justify me having any right or any privilege because I have excluded that. Because no longer am I, watch this, alive, but Christ who is alive in me. And when Christ lives in me, now I know how to act. I know how to act when things come up. I know how to act when stuff goes wrong. I know how to act when situations form up. I know how to act when the acting is not lining up with the word of God. So you got to know how to shake some things that are not in line with the word of God. Remember Wednesday, I said, are we on one accord? Are we the same accord? Are we the same mind? Are we the same love? Then this word must be prevalent to you as well as it is to me. And it must become personal. That now I let this word live in me. Oh, when that word lives in you, you're lacking nothing. But you have to know that you know that you know that you know that you know that God is on your side. You have to have it already implanted in your mind. That God has your best interest at hand. You have to already walk in confidence, courage, faith, belief, trusting God, hoping and trusting in God as the source of your everything, that he will supply all of your needs according to his riches and glory. See, that takes me out of the equation. I don't have to worry about my stuff. I have to know it's all about him and what he's about to do for me because it's already done. See, when you do the work, you don't have to for the reward to happen. The reward has already been done. Christ already died on the cross. He already saved your soul. He already defeated. He already broke the veil. And he's already, watch this, prepared a place for you. Just like he's prepared a place for me. But you have to know it. You have to be so courageous in him that you know it. And then on top of that, it's not just for you to know it. It's for me to show it, my God. That somebody else says, oh man, that guy there is living proof that God lives, not him. He's living proof that God works, not him. He's living proof that God fixes, not him. He's living proof that God heals, not him. A lot of people say, and I do have a healing ministry. You know why? Because he healed me. Woo! Because he healed me. I got a healing ministry to tell you he'll heal you. You know, and I can't take that mantle on me and say I'm the healer. No, I'm not. I'm just the proof that he heals. I'm the proof that it's already done. I'm the proof that he's still working in my favor. I'm the proof, and so are you. But you have to know it like you know it, like you know it, like you know it. And here's another thing. If you skip down, and I want to just ask you guys to read James chapter 1, the whole thing. That's your assignment this weekend, just to get into that revelation of separation of mind. Knowing you can't be double-minded, it must be, watch this, put together. It must be joined. See, there's a battle in your mind for who's in control. Is the world in control or are you in control? The Bible says, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind. What is your mind on? What is your mind set on? Have you made a decision that, first of all, let me tell you now, God didn't do it. Go down to verse 12. It said, blessed is the man and woman, and I tell you this all the time, if it was different, in the old covenant, I have nothing to do with the old covenant because he sent his son for a new covenant. And he came that all might have life and have life more abundantly. So he's talking to you. He says, Blessed is the man who endures temptation. For when he has been proved, he will receive the crown of life, which the Lord has promised to those who love him. Let no one say that he was tempted. I am tempted by God. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone. But each one is tempted when he is drawn away by his own desires and enticed. Oh my God. Devil didn't make you do it, and God surely didn't. That was you. That was me. That was my selfishness. There was them old desires. There was them old enticements. But I have to tell you, and I have to tell everybody, that God is not a tempter. He is a redeemer. He is a drawer. He is a, watch this, creator. My God. And he's ready to create you right now. Go over to 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Verse 3. We're going to start at verse 3. Because you got to know, when you count the joy, here's something that you can take with you to count in joy. 2 Corinthians chapter 1. When you count it all joy, James 1, read James 1, the whole chapter. Make it, I told you, read it four times. First time to get familiar. And before you read the word of God, go intentionally before the Lord and say, Lord, I want to receive from your word. I want to know more. I want the veil to be lifted. I want the revelation to be dropped on me. As I go in here intentionally to find your instructions, that first time familiarity, that second time you now go before him and say, Lord, I just want to indulge and engage. That third time you want to go up in there and you want to say, you know what, now I'm ready for revelation. Oh, and that fourth time, my God, you ready to preach now, because now you have been given the revelation and the wisdom of the word of God that you can live, and you can live right now. Watch this. Verse 3, 2 Corinthians chapter 1. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of mercies and God of all comfort, my God, who comforts us all in our tribulations, that we may be able to comfort those who are in trouble, any trouble, with the comfort with which we ourselves are comforted by God. For as the sufferings of Christ abound in us, so our consolation also abounds through Christ. Now, if we are afflicted, it is for your consolation and salvation, which is effected for the enduring the same sufferings which we also suffer. Or if we are comforted, it is for your consolation and salvation. And our hope for you is steadfast, because we know that as you are partakers of the sufferings, you are also, you will be partakers of the consolation, my God. Let me tell you, when you count it all joy, it's already been done for you. Christ has already, watch this, Christ has already blessed you. Christ has already served. Christ has already died. Christ has already returned just for you. The whole process is of God sending his only begotten son was that you, me and you could also tell somebody about the only begotten son. Yes, Jesus Christ, our Lord. He wants to bless you, but he wants to bless you, watch this, because he got your back. He'll never leave you. What he says, who comforts us in all our tribulations, that we may be able to comfort those who are in trouble also. I told you this before, we need each other. We do. We need each other. You cannot do this thing alone. I cannot do this all by myself. We need each other. We need to be more like-minded. Remember? Same accord. Same mind. Same love. And then it says the same, watch this, the same mind is available to each and every one of us, because that's what he said in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 5. He says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. To love somebody that doesn't know what love is. And I bet it's you. That's where it started with me. I was the first one that had to learn about love and knowing what real love is, and only the love that comes from God. I thank God today. I do. I thank God that we can fellowship together. This is a a day in America. We are saluting Senator John McCain. We are saluting the Queen of Soul, Minister, Prophetess, Evangelist, Aretha Franklin. We know that to be absent from the body is to be present with the Lord. I know she is up in heaven looking down on that service today and saying, wow, look how many people showed up. I must have been loved on earth. But let me get it right. Am I loved up here? My God. So we salute them today. We're not going to keep you long today. We know you want to look at all the shows and things that are on there today. But I just want to give you that encouraging word today that God is there for you. He didn't forget about you. He didn't lead you astray. He didn't tempt you. No, he didn't. Let God off the hook. Let God be God. Let God truly be God. It's up to us to start to act like it, that he's really God. That's why we're so hyped about I am the living proof. Because I am the living proof that God works. I am the living proof that God fixes. He's still in the healing power. I bet you we can get 50 testimonies right now of how he healed you. Tell you how he healed me. And then all I can do is tell you that he'll heal you. Don't take on the mantle that you're the healer. No, you're the healed still. You're still the saved. You're still the blessed. You're still the faithful. You don't elevate over that. You cannot over elevate God. You can't be God out, but you can acknowledge and just acknowledge and just acknowledge and just acknowledge and tell somebody that he's real. That's the biggest thing that we can do is tell somebody that he is real. Amen. Well, family, God bless you today. I want to open up the portion room right now and I give freely into the portion room. I pray for the whole services, John McCain and Aretha Franklin right now, that everybody leaves there different than they came. I pray a spirit of forgiveness. I pray for a spirit of love. I pray for a spirit of oneness. Same one accord, same mind, same love. To be over and about that whole, each one of those ceremonies and any other ceremony across this country. I pray for those million minds that we're pulling. Oh, I'm pulling mine. I'll help you pull yours too. Help me pull them minds back to Christ. Sanity. I thank you, Heavenly Father God. I glorify you, Heavenly Father God. I worship you today, Lord. You are worthy of all our praise. And in Jesus' name we pray and all agreement said, amen. Family, wake up in your mind. Get in your thinking and move in your purpose. God bless.